Okay, so this is lecture 30. Okay, so the last thing we were looking at was convolutional codes, encoders for convolutional codes. I think I stopped at the trellis, right? We described trellis and we stopped there. The encoder for a convolutional code can be conveniently described by this generator matrix in the detransform domain, right? In the detransform domain, and in a typical situation, it would have G, what did I call it? 0D? This is what I called it? G0D, G1D, so on. Okay, so let's say it'll G, GM. M is not a good word. I think I need a what? M minus one. Okay. You like M? Do M. This would nicely describe encoder for a rate. What? Rate 1/m convolutional code. Convolutional encoder. So remember, I have not really defined what a convolutional code is. There's a distinction between the code and the encoder, you might remember, but we will just bother about the encoder and not worry about the code as much. Okay, so it's a strict way of properly defining it, and the code becomes linear and all that nicely happens, but I'll just gloss over the whole. And we saw there are a few other things that are important. Number of states is very important. How do you compute number of states? Number of states, 2 to the power, number of memory elements, right? Number of memory elements. And in the example we saw, the number of memory elements was 3 and it was an 8 state encoder, okay? And then next thing that's important is a trellis representation. Okay, and it's nothing but a state diagram with the time axis, right? So you do the state diagram with the time axis. And there are a few things that were illustrated in the trellis representation. The first thing is paths correspond to code words, right? So each code word is split into several stages. The output you get in each stage, all of that is put together in one path, and you get a code word of the entire convolutional code that goes out. Okay, so paths and code words have a correspondence, and each path is made up of what? Path is a, well, this is another terminology here. Each path is said to be a sequence of branches. Okay, so in each stage, you have a branch, you have branches, several branches, and you put a whole bunch of branches together in a valid path, you get a path in the trellis, and then each path will correspond to a code word. Okay, so all that you can see easily. There was this other notion with respect to the trellis, which was termination, right? Suppose you have k input bits. After your k input bits have been clocked in, you have to clock in as many zeros as the number of memory elements to drive yourself back to the all zero state. And we are only looking at convolutional codes like that. Okay, so we don't want to see something else that's happening. So that's an extra, say, mu bits. So this number of memory elements I'll denote as mu. Okay, so extra mu bits get clocked in. Okay, so that will correspond to an extra m times mu bits that came out. So your entire encoding will take you from k bit message to what? It's not simply k times m, it is k plus mu times m bit code word. Okay, so this is because of the termination, all zero to all zero termination. Okay, so once you do this, it's fine. So one can, if you want, list out all the code words of the convolutional code. That's possible. Okay, is there a mistake here or fine? K plus mu times m. Okay, so one can list out all the possible code words of the convolutional code by considering all the possible messages, and you can even think of it as a block code in this format. Once you fix the message length, it becomes like a block code. You can even think of it that way. Okay, so this is a brief look at what we saw. So I'm going to do one more example for a four state encoder, which is easier to plot and all this. So in an example, four states is always easier than eight state. You might remember I was struggling last class by doing all these arrows. It's too painful. Four state is very easy. So we'll look at a nice and simple example for a four state encoder. I'll take g of d to be 1 plus d plus d squared, then 1 plus d squared. Okay, so this is my generator matrix description. From here I can go very easily to the actual encoder. I have 2D flip-flops. How did I conclude there were 2D flip-flops? D square is the maximum term that shows up. So the only delay, the maximum delay I'll have to do is by 2 time units, nothing more than that. Once I do that, and what is the rate of this encoder? Rate half, right? 1 by 2 encoder. You'll have two XOR gates, one here, one here. The first XOR gate is connected to all, well, the input and the two state bits, and the second one is connected to the input and the and one of the state bits. Okay, and you get your two outputs. This will be your sequence U, this is your sequence V0, this is your sequence V1. Okay, this is a very simple diagram for a four state. So I'm going to do a trellis now for this. Okay, I'll do a very simple. I'll do the complete trellis. I won't start at all zero and do the slow thing. I'll do the complete trellis. It's not too difficult to do. Okay, so there are four states. How did we index them? 0, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so I can do that. Right, this is 0, 1, 2. And 3. Again, you need a convention for the sequencing, right? So we always did S0, S1. Okay, so stick to that. Okay, the state is S0, S1. Okay, so when I say state is 1, what do I mean? S0 is 0 and S1 is 1. Okay, that's what I mean when I say the state is 1. When I say the state is 2, what do I mean? S0 is 1 and S1 is 0. Okay. Okay, so you have the same states here. Okay, so once I know it's a four state encoder, and once I know there are no feedback elements, it's just feed forward elements, the transitions are easy to write down. Okay, the edges are easy to put down, the branches are easy to put down. You don't need any more information for the branches. Okay, you need more information for the outputs. Okay, so for the branches it's very easy. For instance, from the all zero state, what are the other states you can go to? 0, 0 and 1, 0, which is 0 and 2. I can't go to anything else. Okay, so that is very easy to write down. And even the inputs can be written down. This will happen with input 0. This will happen with input 1. Okay, the only thing you can't write without any other information is the output, without knowing the g of d completely. Okay, now that we know g of d completely, one can easily write down. What will be the output for 0? 0, 0. For 1, it will be 1, 1. Okay, that's very easy. What about from state 1? 1, 0. The same two states are reachable from state 1. Okay, and what about input output? One would be? Okay, what about from 2? Well, it's so clear, I mean, only from 2 it can only be 1 and 3. So these things will have to be nice and symmetric. They can't take arbitrary shapes. So okay, the only thing to figure out is 0 would be 1 0. Then 1 would be 0, 1. Okay. Okay, so for 3, when 0 is input, 1 0 0 1 0 1, and for 1 it would be 1 0. Okay, so that is my trellis, complete stage of my trellis. Okay, so out of each, well, each state, each state on the left hand side, how many branches go out? 2. Okay, corresponding to the input 0 and input 1. Okay, and into each state on the right hand side, how many branches come in? 2. Okay, and in this case, for the feed forward case, both those branches that are coming in will correspond to the same bit. Okay, it will be only 0. Okay, it's very clear, because a 0 will have to be equal to the bit that came in last. Okay, so from that you can easily conclude what bit that will be. Okay, so these are all sanity checks. You can see that is satisfied. If that is not satisfied, then you have made some goof somewhere. You know, simple checks that you can do to check that things like that have come up. Okay. So for instance, there are a lot of definitions that one can do. Okay, one can say the next state, when the present state is 0, what are the two next states possible? 0 and 2. Okay, so you can call them next states. And from 0, what are the two, if corresponding to 0 on the right hand side, what are the previous states that are possible? 0 and 1. Okay, so all these things are possible previous states, possible next states. Okay, so all these, they'll depend on this particular trellis. Okay, so simple thing to write down. Okay, so what's very nice about the trellis is it's very easy to visualize your decoding happening on the trellis. And as I said, the trellis is used for doing maximum likelihood decoding for convolutional codes. Okay, so that's what we'll see next, maximum likelihood decoding for convolutional codes. Okay, which is called the Viterbi decoder. Okay, so I won't prove any difficult properties for the Viterbi decoder. None of them are very difficult. It's very intuitive. I think most of you must have already seen the Viterbi decoder in one form or the other before. So I'll just describe it and then give you a justification for why it works. Okay, and then we'll just take it from there. It's not too difficult. Okay, all right. So first we need a whole bunch of notation to set up the whole issue. So I'll say I have a rate 1 by m convolutional encoder. Okay, I'll say memory is mu. Okay, so these two things I say. I'm going to look at a message which is, I'll start with U1 just for convenience, U1, U2, all the way to UK. I'm sending out K messages. What will be the code word corresponding to this? Okay, so I'll have to write down V01, V11, V02, V12, okay, all the way to what? V0K, V1K, and then what? You have to do more, right? So you have to go all the way from V0, K plus 1, V1K plus mu, all the way to V0. K plus mu, V1, K plus mu. Okay, so that will be my code word, right? So imagine that this code word is being transmitted through with BPSK modulation over AWGN. Okay. Oh, I've done rate half. Huh? So I'll have to do okay, let's say I'm doing this for rate half. Okay, so if you have rate 1 by m, what should I do? V1, I'll go all the way to m minus 1. Okay, so maybe I should have done that now. Okay, so I'll just do rate half, and then I'll mention wherever the change is needed. I'll tell you where the changes will bring in. Okay, so excuse me for that. Should have seen that happening. It's more, I didn't see it. Just wrote down V0 and V1. This is for rate half. If you have rate say 1 by m, then this will go all the way from V01, V11 to Vm minus 1, 1. Okay, so that's how it will go. So we'll have examples. sorry. So the received word corresponding to this, okay, I'm going to call it in a similar way, R01, R11, R02, R12, R0K, R1K, R0K plus 1, you know, the whole thing. I need the whole received values. All these received values are quite meaningful, even though I knew. Okay, so our goal is to find only U1 to UK, right? I don't care really about anything else. I only want to find U1 to UK. Okay, so you see, there's a very natural and simple way to associate. Since this entire received vector R can be broken down into stages of the trellis. Okay, so if I now write down the trellis, entire trellis, I'll start with the all zero state. Okay, in the first stage, what would have been the received values? R01 and R11, right? Those would be the received values corresponding to the first stage. Okay, corresponding to the second stage of my trellis, what would be the received values? R02 and R12. Okay, so likewise. Okay, so I can associate each of these received values to different stages of my trellis. Okay, exactly like what I did with my message and code word bits, right? Each of these were associated to particular stages of the trellis. I'll do the same thing. Okay, stage K. This one is stage K plus. Okay, so once you do that, you can imagine doing decoding on the trellis. But before we go there, I want to first write down the ML rule and then try to simplify that and then see how that works out with respect to the trellis. So what is my ML rule? Maximum likelihood rule for BPSK AWGN. Actually, I can simplify it to the correlation, maximum correlation, but we will just keep it as minimum distance just for now. Okay, so what should you do? You should do argument of the minimum over all symbol vectors, all code symbols, what should you minimize? R minus S square. Okay, so the squared Euclidean distance you have to minimize. Okay, so let me try to write this down. You'll see this is actually a summation, and you can even split that summation over several stages. Okay, so we'll do something like that. Okay, we'll see what each thing contributes, and we'll try to do we'll try to break up this minimization into a minimization done recursively over stages. Okay, so that's the whole point of the Viterbi decoder. We'll try to do that next. Okay, so let me look at this R minus S squared. It's a summation from I equals 1 to K plus mu, okay, R0i minus S, I need some notation, I'll just do S0i squared plus R1i minus S1i squared. Okay, can I do that? So what is this S0 and Si? This S I've split as what? S0. 1, S1, 1, S0, 2, S1, 2, all the way to S0, K plus mu, S1, K plus mu. Just like I split V, I can split S. What is the relationship between S and V? The BPSK relationship. 0 goes to plus 1 and 1 goes to minus 1. That's all. So this is how I've split the symbol vector. And you see, naturally, this summation nicely breaks down into a summation over several stages. Okay, in each stage, see, this is a term that corresponds to a particular stage, and more specifically, in that stage, it corresponds to each branch. Okay, each branch of a stage corresponds to different possible values for S0i and S1i. Okay, so let's focus on that a little bit. If I look at stage I, okay, an arbitrary stage I, I'm going to have, for simplicity, I'll stick to the state, four state encoder. Okay, so the same thing will work for any number of states. I'll just use the four-state encoder for reasons of simplicity. Okay, so there's no reason why it will not work for anything else. I can also do a general diagram, but it's just be more of a distraction than anything else. So my diagram is going to look like this, right? Okay, this is how my diagram is going to look in stage I. Okay, corresponding to stage I, what are my received values? R0i and R1i. Okay, so this is common to the entire stage, but each branch of the stage corresponds to different possible values for S0i and S1i. For instance, here we wrote what? 0, 0, 0. So that branch actually corresponds to plus 1, plus 1. Okay, so here we wrote 1, 1, 1. So this branch actually corresponds to minus 1, minus 1. Okay, different possible values for S0i and S1i. Okay, so in each stage, that's what corresponds to. Okay, so the next useful definition when using this trellis is to define something called a branch metric. In each stage, you want to compute a metric for the branch. Okay, so this term for each branch, you compute that term and keep it ahead of time, store it ahead of time. That is called a branch metric. Okay, so that's what we'll define next. So branch metric. Okay, each branch corresponds to a particular value for S0i and S1i. Okay, the branch metric, okay, maybe BM for short, is basically Ri0 minus Si0 squared plus Ri1 minus Si1 squared. That is my branch metric. Okay. So if I give you actual specific values for Ri0 and Ri1, say 0.5, 0.4, okay, you can compute the exact branch metrics for each of those branches. Okay, and it's very typical in doing the Viterbi decoder to actually write the branch metrics on top of each branch. Okay, on the encoding side, we wrote the 0 given 0, 0. On the decoding side, it's more common to write the branch metric on each branch. You already have the Ris. And you know the branch metrics are what will appear in the decoder. Okay? That's what you have to try to minimize, etc. Okay, so you write the branch metric on top of each branch on each stage. Just write down the whole thing. Okay, so there's no big calculation here. If you think in complexity, in terms of complexity, for each stage, your complexity is 2 power mu. Okay, it's not growing with n, which is your block length. Okay? It's not with k, which is your message length or block length or whatever. It's only 2 power mu. So it's not very complex. Okay, typically ML decoder, what do you expect the complexity to be? 2 power k, right? 2 power k, 2 power n, that's the kind of complexity. It's only 2 power mu, and if it's 4 state, 8 states, it's not too difficult to imagine. Okay, so at least this computation is not too bad. One can do it. Okay, so that's the branch metric. Okay, so the next definition is, for path metric. Okay, very easy definition. Okay, what is a path after all? Sequence of branches. What will be a path metric then? Let's add up all the branch metrics. Okay, so if path is branch 1, comma branch 2, so on till, let's say branch, I don't know, some A. Okay, path metric equals summation of branch metric of branch I goes from 1 to A. Okay, so now remember, this path need not be a complete path which actually corresponds to a full code word. Okay, so I've not said anything about this path corresponding to a code word. What can I do is I can define this for any path that starts anywhere and ends anywhere, as long as it's a valid path. See, remember, from one state, I can't go to all the four states. It has to be a valid path on the trellis. Okay, so it should be a valid, proper, connected path. And any partial path, I can define a path metric. There's nothing wrong with this definition. Okay, so every path this way will have a starting state and an ending state, and several states that it will go through. So I can also describe the path as a sequence of states. Okay, right now I wrote down as a sequence of branches. I can also write down the path as what? The same path can be written as a sequence of states. Okay, so how many states will I need if I have A branches? A plus 1, right? So you have a starting state and then every branch will introduce one more state. Okay, the starting state is there and then every branch will introduce one more state. So you'll have A plus 1 state. So I can describe the same path as state 1, state 2, so on till state A plus 1. In this description, it's that the restrictions imposed by the trellis will be slightly clearer. For instance, if state 1 is 0, what can state 2 be? 0 or 2, right? I know that. So in branches, maybe I don't have notation for the branch, but the states are very, very easy to write down. Okay, so now the path metric will be what? The exact same thing, except that instead of describing, okay, instead of writing down branch metric of branch I, I'm going to say branch metric of the branch that connects state I to state I plus 1. I'll simply call that state I connects to state I plus 1. Okay, so these are all notations. I mean, one can have so many different fancy notations for the Viterbi decoder, but it's just to get the terminology out and the way you think about how the minimization happens. There's nothing more beyond that. Okay, so this is a very common way of thinking of a path. Okay, so sequence of states that correspond to a valid path on the trellis. Okay, so that's one other definition. Okay, so now my ML decoder, right? So the next thing is, what is this path metric now? Suppose I actually have a complete path from all zero state to all zero state that corresponds to a valid code word. This path metric will be what? Will be the actual thing I compute in my ML decoder. Mod R minus S squared. Okay, so what will be mod R minus S squared? Be equal to the path metric of the path corresponding to S. Okay, so that's the next thing. It's very easy to see that also. Equals path metric of path corresponding to S. Okay, all these things are quite elementary in hindsight, but believe me, when the Viterbi decoder was introduced, all these were quite fancy corresponding to S. Okay, you know, S corresponds to a code word. That code word definitely corresponds to a path on the trellis from the all zero state to the all zero state. So if you do it to that path and compute its path metric, it will be exactly equal to mod R minus S square. Okay, so now I can describe my ML rule as minimize argument of the minimization over paths path metric. Okay, so that's another thing I can. The path metric. Okay, I know every path corresponds to a valid code word. I can go back to the code word or the message sequence once I do that. Okay, so this kind of a description on the graph is very intuitive and nice and clear to see, and you'll see it will simplify the way you think and implement your algorithm drastically. Okay, so you'll see 2 power mu is pretty much the complexity you need. 2 power k will disappear. Be something like k times 2 power mu as opposed to 2 power k, which you normally think of the ML decoder, right? You go over all the code words, you don't have to do that. You can do it stage wise, and the only complexity you incur is 2 power mu and not 2 power k. Okay, so that becomes a very useful device. Okay, so the crucial argument in seeing how that happens is, instead of minimizing over all the paths in one go, just blindly computing the path metric for each path, you try to concentrate on a particular state at a particular stage and look at all the paths that pass through that state. Okay, so that's what I'm going to do. I have this is kind of the argument for the Viterbi decoder. I'll try to write down the decoder formally. It's not very great. It's not very difficult to write down. But first, I'll give you the argument for the minimization, which you can see. This is the argument for the Viterbi decoder. Okay, so you know you started at the all zero state, and you know you ended at the all zero state. This is stage 1, and this is stage k plus mu. Okay, right? In some stage I, in intermediate stage I, okay, you actually have the trellis, right? Okay, so let me write down. Once again, I'm using the four state thing just for illustration. The same thing works on Anything else? Okay, so you can see I'm struggling to draw even the four-state one. So leave alone, try to draw anything else that's fancy. Okay, so here's the argument. Okay, suppose I focus on, say, this state. Okay, so I focused on this state. Okay. Okay, some particular state at some particular stage. Okay, so at a particular stage I am focusing on a particular state. Right? So now I ask the question, out of all the paths that pass through this state, okay, suppose I want to minimize the path metric. I want to find that path which would have the least metric. Okay, so that's the question I'm going to ask. You might ask me, what's the relationship between this and the ML rule? Of course, there's a close relationship. We'll see that soon enough. Okay, so if I say, suppose I identify this state as some SI, okay, state I, maybe I'll write it as state I. You'll see there'll be a nice simplification that will happen. Okay, suppose I ask this question, I want to find argument of minimization over all paths that pass through state I, okay, which is in stage I, which is on the right hand side of the stage I, okay, path metric. Okay, you'll see this problem can be done in two stages. I don't have to look at all the paths, find the complete path metric, okay, and then do it. I can do from stage 1 to stage I and then stage I to stage k plus mu separately and then add both of them. Okay, that was made possible because I insisted that every path has to go through state I. It has to go through state I. So what will happen? You'll be looking at a whole bunch of paths which intersect like this. Okay, some paths here and then a whole bunch of paths which intersect here. So the path metric here will be equal to the path metric from, for every path, the path metric will be equal to the path metric from stage 1 to stage I, then stage I plus 1 to stage k plus mu. And why is it that I can do the minimization separately? So it's very clear because they intersect at state I, right? All of them have a common state I. So this term has to go through this, okay? So it's enough if you do, let me change my pen color. Okay, so looks like I can't change my pen color. Okay, suppose I have the red path here, red path here. Okay, what is the red path now? Okay, so this is for the, this is the argument for the, so this is the question that I'm going to ask now. I'm going to ask two other problems. Okay, so one is you do the argument over minimization. Sorry. So you'll say paths from 0 to state I. Okay, path. So I think I'm getting too clumsy here. So let me just move to the next page. I think it's probably a better way of doing it. I'm going to ask another question now. I'm going to say, let's look at this thing, partial minimization. Okay, so you minimize over paths from state 0 at stage 1, okay, so well at stage 1 to state I after stage I. Okay, if you do this minimization of path metric, okay, you will get something. Okay, so this is what I'm going to call as P1. Okay, this is what I've drawn in red here. This guy is P1. Okay, so instead of worrying about the path from state 0 all the way out to state 0, I'm going to say, let me stop at state I and only look at those paths and do a minimization. Okay, suppose I did that somehow. Okay, I'm not claiming that's very easy, but maybe I did that somehow. If I did that, and then maybe I also did a similar thing from state I to state 0 after stage k plus mu. Okay, maybe I did that also. Okay, so maybe I did that also, which will be very similar to this. So I'm going to cut and paste from here. Suppose I did the same thing okay, state I, after stage I, to stage 0 after stage k plus mu, and then maybe I got path p2. Okay, those two paths are shown here in red. Okay, I'm going to claim this guy, this minimization is equal to just an adjoining of p1 and p2. Okay, so you can see. You can see why it has to be true. Okay, it makes a lot of sense. You are forced to go through state I. There's nothing else you can do. So you better pick the least path that goes there and then pick the least path again. It's very intuitive and clear, but you can also rigorously prove it. You assume there's another path here which could have been chosen, and then you'll see that path metric will really be not the largest one. You can take P1, P2 to be the largest one. Okay, so it's a very simple argument, but this argument tends to simplify, ends up simplifying the whole thing. If I don't place this restriction on passing through state I cannot make this argument. Okay. You can easily convince yourself that that's true. If I don't fix the particular state on which, through which it has to pass through, I cannot make the splitting argument. Once I force that, I can do this. So what the Viterbi algorithm does is, does this calculation of P1 for each state I in each stage recursively, stage by stage. Once you keep doing that, by the time you end up with the last one, you'll automatically have the minimum path. Okay. So that's what the Viterbi algorithm does. So I'll try to quickly write down the formal procedure for what you do in stage I. Okay, it will be quite clear, and then we'll see a couple of examples of how to do the Viterbi algorithm maybe next class, and that will be the end of this discussion. Okay, so here's the Viterbi algorithm. Okay, so I think the best thing to do is to start with an example. I think that's a better thing to do. Let me start with an example. Go through that. Yes. So you want to do it in reverse, kind of. Okay. Okay. Yes. So maybe I'll describe the example, and then after that you can ask this question. Because I think the question is clear to me, but let me answer it after I talk about the example. Okay, so the next thing I'm going to do is an example. So suppose we use this four state code that we have. Maybe the received value is, I don't know, we'll just pick some values, 0.5, 0.7, minus 0.1, what more do you want, minus 0.5, how many k's do we have to transmit? So I have a memory 3, right? So I think I need quite a few, so maybe I'll run out of time, so we'll see. See, I'll just do it for a few states. So okay, so we'll make up values as we go along. Okay, so I'll draw it on the trellis, I think that's easier. Okay, so the first stage 1 will have what? Just two branches. Okay, so you went from 0 to 0 or, oops, something very crazy is happening. Well, it's just refusing to do something. Okay, so let me try something. Let me just go to the next page and hope everything works out as planned. Okay, so here's an example. Okay, so I'm going to say, okay, so initially I start at the all zero state, and then I have to compute the branch matrix, right? So that's the first, that's the first step in the Viterbi algorithm. So you compute the branch matrix. So maybe this is 0 0 1 1 1. So maybe the received values here were 0.5 and 0.7. Okay, so let's do a quick computation. What will be the branch metric for the top one and the bottom one? I don't think you need a calculator here. You can do a computation very easily. .34 for the top one. Is that fine? Okay, so 0.34 for the top one. And then for the bottom one, you would have 0.34 is not correct, huh? Yeah, 5.49 for the bottom one. Yeah, that makes sense. I don't know, 1.5 square is what, 2.25, right? Plus 1.7, which would be 2.89. So it can't be 5.49. 5.14, okay. So it doesn't matter really, but so you imagine the kind of computation that's required. Okay, so now you begin by asking the same question. So which path to state 0, okay, to state 0 after stage 1 would give you the least path metric. So if you ask that question, how do you get 5.14? You tell me. No, see, 0 goes to plus 1, 1 goes to minus 1. Okay. Okay, so you have to do the BPSK modulation. Don't do it with 0 and 1. Is that okay? We are okay? Alright, so now you ask the question. You fix yourself at state 0. And then say, which is the least path metric path that would have come here? There's really no question. You already know what that path is. So you just take your red color and color that path. Okay, so now you ask the same question for state 2. There's really no question to ask. That is your this path. Okay, so it's useful, you'll see as you run this algorithm, to have the path metric for your best paths also stored readily. Okay, so you'll see that is very useful. Okay, as you do the computation. So it's very common to compute the path metric of the best path to state 0 and write it down right below state 0. So that would be 0.34. Okay, so here the path metric for the best path to state 2 is 5.14. Okay, so these things have a name. They're called state metrics, for instance. Okay, so if you want, you can call it state metric, or just it's for convenience to compute your next path very easily. Okay, in the next stage of my trellis, I would have 4 states. Okay, and the transitions would be from 0, it goes to 0 and 2, right? And from 2, it goes to 1 and 4. Okay, so maybe my received values were minus 0.1, minus 0.3. Okay, alright. So now, first step in each stage is to compute the branch metrics. So you go ahead and compute the branch metrics for each branch. Okay, so if you want some help with the outputs, I guess it's, you don't have to write for some things. Two point eight, two point nine. Yeah. 0.9 for this one. For this one, it is 1.3. Am I right? Okay. So these two, what are the outputs? 0.1 and 1.0. If I'm not right, 1.0 and 0.1. Okay, go ahead and do that. 2.5 and 2.5 and 1.7. Fine. So now I ask the same question again. After stage 2, suppose I focus on this guy. Okay. What is the path? What is the minimum path? There's no real question because there's only one branch coming in. So I don't have anything else to say. So I'll just pick my red pen and select this. So I can continue. I can do the same thing for every state because there's only one path that comes into every state now. So that has to be the minimum path. There's nothing else that one can do about it. So I can just paint everything red. No problem. And then continue to write down that minimum path metric below each state. Okay, so this would be what? For first path is 2.9 plus 0.34, which is 3.24. Am I right? This one would be 7.64. This one would be 1.64. This one would be 6.84. So that's it. You see how easy it is, right? So nothing difficult about the Viterbi decode. It's just addition and squaring. That's nothing more is required. Okay, so I'm running out of time slowly, but let's do one more stage. You'll see something interesting happen in the next stage, I hope. Okay, so next stage, you have many more transitions, but just as do it carefully. So many other transitions are there, but let me just focus on these two right now, these four right now. Don't do the remaining, just do these four just to see some clarity, and then we'll proceed further. Okay, can you find the branch metrics for these things? I have to give you the received values. I'll say received values are 0.5 minus 0.5. What are the branch metrics for 0, 0? No, don't be so sure. What is the top one? 2.5. Okay. What about the next one? Okay, all these four will be 2.5. Am I right? Okay, so I guess then this is a bad example. So let's change one of these values. Maybe I'll make it 0.1, 0.5, 0.1. Okay, I'm sorry about that. So redo the computation a little bit. I don't want all of them to be 2.5, just for fun, you know. It's not, they can be 2.5. Yeah. What do you get then? 1.06, bottom one. Three point four six. Okay, and 3.46, 1.06. Am I right? Okay. So you see, there could be smart ways of simplifying a calculation when you implement, right? For each branch metric, you don't have to do the same computation over and over again. Several branches would have the same metric because they have the same output. The same metric has to be there. So now let's ask this question. Let's focus on stage 0 after stage 2 and try to ask the question, what is the minimum metric path that will end at stage 0 after stage 2? If I ask that question now, you see, there's a very interesting way of answering that question. I know there are two possible ways in which I could have come to stage 0. Okay, one way would have been to be at stage 0 before, okay, or state 1 before, and I know what the best way of getting to those states are. Okay, and then I use my property that once I know I have to go through state 2 or state 1 at a particular stage, I can split my minimization into two different stages. So here the second stage is very trivial. It's just only one branch, right? So I split it into two stages. One stage is already solved. I know already what the best path is to end up here. I'll simply look at the next one and add it. Okay. So here what happens is the first path is going to give me an overall metric of 3.24 plus 1.06, which is 4.3. And the bottom path is going to give me a metric of something much larger than that, 7.64 plus 3.46, which is some 11 point. So out of these two paths, I'll only pick the top one and not pick the bottom one. So when I pick my red pen out, I'm going to just shade this guy and then say my branch metric is my path met, my metric after that is 4 point. The other transition I will disallow. Okay, so disallowing transitions like this is very key to the Viterbi algorithm. For the next stage also one can do it. You'll see the top one once again qualifies. Okay, so it's got slightly lesser. So you see these two are the 2 parts. Okay, so one can do a similar thing for these two things. Okay, so for these two also what will happen, the two transitions are this and this, you will get a red somewhere. So I'm going to stop now. We'll pick up from this exact same point tomorrow.